But you have never failed me yet. No, no. I'm waiting for change to come. Knowing the battle's won. For you have never failed me.
Still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet.
Never fail me yet.
Jesus, you're still enough.
Keep me within your love.
Keep me within your love.
My heart will sing.
My heart will sing your praise again.
Your promise still stands, yeah.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faith.
Your faithfulness, your faithfulness.
I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet.
You never failed me yet. No, no.
Oh. Hi, everybody. I'm Pastor Mike. I'm pastor of Living Hope Church, and I'm glad to be with you once again after about 4.5 months of coming to you in this way. I hope it's working for you. I really do. I want you to know that I miss you incredibly, and I look forward to when we can all be together and meet together as a body of believers. Today, we're going over Haggai chapter 1, and my highlight verses are verses 4 through 7 and verse 14. But in order to get to the message or what God has laid on my heart for this and what he's teaching me, I have to set the backdrop of what's going on during this time. So Haggai is the first of the post-exilic minor prophets. In other words, after the exile to Babylon, there's three prophets. It's Haggai, it's Malachi, and it's Zechariah. And each of these return after the 70-year exile to come back, and they speak on the rebuilding of the temple. It's also somewhat contemporary with Nehemiah and Ezra, two books in the Minor Prophets. Minor Prophets, these are powerful books. They're not minor because of their lack of power. They're minor just because of their size. They're relatively small, like this is a two-chapter book. So what's the state of Jerusalem at this time? Well, the former kingdom, it's gone. They've been taken into captivity, and they've been there for 70 years. The temple, the state of the temple it's a heap of rocks, basically. It's in ruins, and it's in great need of repair. The population is but a small remnant of people. It's not what it once was, but I believe they're faithful people. So knowing that, In 538 BC, King Cyrus of Persia allows the exiled Jews to return to Jerusalem after 70 years of captivity. 2 years later, the construction of the temple begins and is led by Zerubbabel. The work stopped after 2 years. So in 534 BC, after 14 years of neglect, work on the temple resumed in 520 BC, and it was finished 4 years later, 4 years later in 516 BC, and this comes from the book of Ezra. So where does that bring us today? It brings us right to Haggai chapter 1, and I'm going to start reading in verse 4. And it says, "Is it time for you yourselves to dwell in paneled houses, and this temple to lie in ruins? Now therefore, thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. You have sown much and bring little. You eat, but you do not have enough. You drink, but you are not filled with drink. You clothe yourselves, but no one is warm. And he who earns wages to put into a bag with holes. Thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways." And then in verse 14 it says, "So the Lord stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, the governor of Judah, and the spirit of Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, and the spirit of all the remnant of the people, and they came and they worked on the house of the Lord of hosts, their God." And my explanation of this gets a little broad, but I think it works. And this is what I found. First off, there's clearly a spirit of selfishness, concern for self before concern for God. And God comes right out and says it in verse 5. He tells them, consider your ways. What ways? The ways that they were living in their own homes, building their own houses, making everything more about them than God himself. And his temple lies in ruins. And he calls them out on it. And he says, take a look at this. Because obviously they didn't get it. So what's going on here? God's work and God himself was secondary to the Jews. And their homes and their work were before God's home, the temple, and his work that he had for them to do. They were about their desires. So verse 6 tells us that though they selfishly strive for themselves, nothing seems to come about as they want. So they're working very hard, but for them. They're making money, they're building beautiful homes, and they're doing all this and doing all that. But it never satisfies. It doesn't seem to be enough. Even though there's money all over and there's wealth coming to them, nothing seems to satisfy. It's insatiable. So what's going on here? They're out of order. And God's order is very clear that he is first. In fact, he says in Matthew 6:33, it says, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and the rest follows. The rest will come." And they're not doing that. They're seeking first their kingdom, themselves. And that's a real problem. In verse 9, it tells us very clearly that it is God who withholds. Why? Because they're out of order. So any blessing that was to come to them, even with their hard work, because it was for them and not for God, he withholds the blessing. I believe he does that today. We have to be in order, but that'll get my application. And then verse 12, we see the cycle run through for the Jewish people. It says, "Then Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, and Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, with all the remnant of the people, obeyed the voice of the Lord their God and the words of Haggai the prophet, as their Lord their God had sent them, and the people feared the presence of the Lord." So what is happening here is they finally come to a place where they obey God. And when they obey God, the next thing they do is they get into the work that God had called them to do. All right. Application. I tried to put myself in the place of God. And believe me, I'm not God. I'm not even, no. But just what I would say if I had that position. And I imagined it. And I said, if I was God, what would I say to these people? Right away, I'd say, what would I have said? I would have said, you have got to be kidding me. Are you serious? Are you putting yourself before me? The one who just delivered you and gave you the opportunity to come back to your temple? Oh, I'd be furious. But then I took a look at myself. And then I said, am I any better than the Jews that came out and put themselves before God? And then I had to start asking myself questions like, is God's work more important than my desires? I have to consider my ways. And you do too. Consider your ways. So what are some things I had to consider? Oh, man. Do I pray for my enemies? God tells me to forgive and to love and to even love your enemies, but to pray for them. Do I do that? Do I see myself as better than Jews of that day? And right now I stand before you and I say, not really. I'm not where I ought to be in that area. Do I share God's salvation message to those who don't know him? Well, I do sometimes, but is it at the level that I believe I'm called to do it? Is it with the passion that I'm called to do it? Not so sure. Do I do the difficult things, which, by the way, will bring about opposition? Like, will I reach out to somebody, and I know to reach out to them, I'm going to feel something that comes back at me, just like they did when they were building the temple. Sometimes I do, and sometimes I don't. Do I look for the easy way out? I have to consider my ways, and you have to consider yours, too. How about my giving? Do I give up my first fruits, or do I wait to see what's left before I give to God? You've heard me say this before. That's been a wrestling match for a good part of my Christian walk. Praise God, he's changing me, and I'm doing much better. But am I staying true to giving of my first fruits, what he requires? Do I refrain from the things that God has called me to refrain from? Or do I get closer and closer to that proverbial fence, that proverbial line in the sand? Do I get closer to that, or do I stay clear of those things he's called me to stay away from? Do I whine and complain when I don't get my way? When everything seems to be like money in a bag with holes, becoming like dust and blowing away. So my application is very clear in this. It's, I have to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and trust that he will bring all other things to me. And I think that's a good lesson for all of us. I have to open my eyes that I see clearly my selfish ways and my fearful ways and step away from those and operate in a spirit of faith instead. I have to change my heart that I can be like those people in verse 12 who came to obedience to God, and they feared God more than they feared the things around them. Then I don't ask God really to stir up the spirit of Zerubbabel in me or the spirit of Joshua, but I ask him to stir up the spirit of God in me, the Holy Spirit, that I live and move and operate by that. I have my being in that. That's what I have to apply to my life. And I can only do that by the power of God who helps me. So my response for this is, Lord Jesus, I ask that you help me to walk in your ways and see the truth of who you are. Help me to be in the right order according to your perfect will. And stir up your Holy Spirit in me, that I might operate with a desire to please God first. I pray that also for the leaders as well in our church, Father, that you would impact them and reach them in such a way that they go beyond, that they would walk according to your purposes with the heart of God and the purposes of God in mind. Lord, bless us all as we move forward for the kingdom of God. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.